Hello.
Hey, how are you?
I'm sorry, are you done?
No, we haven't started. We still have 20 minutes till it starts.
Oh, it's not started yet.
Oh, we had a time change this weekend. So that
I see. I thought I'm late or what happened? There's no one did not.
Okay, people that need to be muted.
I have a question too.
Okay.
On the assignment, we have to do complete writing and study. And should we send the report for to you or what is that?
Are you the healing miracle study? Is that what you're talking about?
No, on the little counseling training schedule, there is an assignment line, complete writing study.
Can anybody
should
help?
You write something and send it?
I can't, I'm sorry, our sound is kind of breaking up here, so I'm not catching everything you're saying.
I think she's saying that on their schedule, it says written, complete written study for today. And
yes,
she was asking, where does she send that written study once?
Okay, thank you. Yeah, the written study is the healing miracle study. So that's in your book. And it's also one that I sent you an extra copy of the healing miracle study. And so for each healing, there. Each healing miracle, you need to do the written study for it. And it's
okay,
several,
thank you.
It's several pages long. It's about 6 pages, isn't it?
Yeah.
But at the end of it, there's a thing called the summary. Don't do the summary.
Right.
Yeah.
Cindy, I mean, we kind of took a stab at one, but we weren't really sure if that meant to do a summary before tonight. Or we were
no, the summary is summary. After you have finished 17 healing miracles, then you do a summary of all of them.
Yeah, I got that part. Just the writing it out, like, are we going to go through?
No, we don't necessarily go through that. It's,
oh, okay.
This is for your learning. And if you do it prior to class, then you've got a lot deeper inside of you and we'll get a lot more out of it. So I encourage you to finish the written healing miracle before you come to the class. And there'll be some of the written ones you will do that we won't necessarily do in class.
Right, because there's 16 of them.
Yeah.
Thanks.
Yeah.
And the role of fig, do you want us to complete that too?
The what?
The role of faith in counseling. Do you want us to complete?
That was a class, that was like the second class we had.
Right.
There was things.
Okay. So that was just for us to take notes on.
Yeah, that was just more class participation that night.
Cindy, I'm also confused about the homework assignment. Okay, can you hear me?
Yes, both are.
Okay, I'm also confused about the homework assignment for Heal the Miracles. There's a lot of things we need to complete. On the book also, you sent some material to us, then every material should we complete and then submit it to you or just some of them? Which part should we complete?
You should complete, for every healing miracle, there is a study that's very long. And you will be doing a minimum of, just a minute. I'm working on it, but there's a lot of things to do.
Then we need to read chapter 11 also too, right?
For
healing miracles of Jesus.
The healing? Yes. I'm trying to find where we're at. Yeah, the healing miracles of Jesus are in Betty's book, and you can read it. You can read what she's written about it, and that will help you understand, as well as I wrote a description of how to do the healing miracle, and that's in your manual.
Oh, okay.
Okay.
We need to complete all the things, right? All of this appendix. Can you hear me?
There are what, 14, 15, 17,
16 and 17 with the good prayer now.
So there's 17 of the healing miracles that you will complete before you get done with the full 3 years of training. So you don't have to do it all right now.
Oh, okay. I
suggest that you do like six of them between the time we started and next May, just so you don't get behind, to do five or six of them a year.
Mm-hmm.
And then we also have the summer when that you can make up work too that you haven't completed, so you have extra time.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, there's plenty of instructions on the Healing Miracles study. It's both in Betty's manual, and then, like I say, I wrote out some specific instructions that are in your manual I sent to you.
Okay, thank you.
You're welcome.
Someone has a question. Yeah, we can hear you now.
The Zoom group chat, I can see the message, but I can't type a response.
Oh. Same here. It says chat disabled at the bottom.
You know, Romy, you know what to do with that? I invite.
It
says chat disabled.
We could read your note though. Mm-hmm. Chat is available. Can everybody see this? We just can't respond.
Okay.
Chat available.
Mm.
I don't know. Mm. Ours works.
So it may be the setting only allows the host.
No, anybody can chat. I don't know.
Is there any settings here?
Yeah, the setting might only allow the host to chat and not the participants.
Hmm.
I can't find where the settings are online.
That you'd actually have to go back to settings to figure that out.
Hmm. Sorry about that.
I can try now.
Yep, it's working.
So that was Romy's magic fingers that fixed that.
Working.
Okay, let's pray. Hmm. Father God, we thank you for each and every person that's able to join tonight. And we lift up those who aren't here, especially Susan Bartley, who's been in rehab. We just pray for her recovery, Lord. Anybody that is not feeling well tonight, we just bring them before you and ask you to touch them physically, Lord. And Father, we thank you for this opportunity. We ask that you'd give us ears to hear as we study your word. Speak to us, teach us, Lord. Direct our feet, direct our hearts and our minds tonight. We ask for the presence of your Holy Spirit to grace us. In Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Okay, so we'll do the healing miracle tonight, and then we have 3 weeks where we're going to be studying life histories. And that's really like the crux of counseling. I think it's something unique to GSM, the way that we do life histories. You know, I've been in other schools where they have you fill out a 20-page form, history form with 100 questions. And we choose not to do that. We choose to do all of our life history, or what most counseling agencies would call case history studies, one-on-one. And we do a very unique form of on a timeline. And the value of that, I see so much in it develops relationship with your client. And during that time of doing the life history, you develop a relationship of trust. So then when you begin to do the deeper work, and when you begin to process some difficult memories or something like that, there's a relationship established there. And the doing the life history will give your client some perspective that maybe they didn't have before you did that. So it's helping them tell their story. So I always love that part of the class. And Elsa Jane's going to come in and do some of that with me.
Am I?
Yeah.
Oh.
I hope so. I asked you a long time
probably
ago. But
well.
Yeah, probably.
That's a long time ago. Yes, I do remember.
Yeah.
I have a question. I have some papers from Benjamin and how he comes on that.
I'll scan it back to him.
Okay.
Okay, is everybody ready?
Yes.
Yes.
So I think, you know, Elsa Jane is out here. In fact, Elsa Jane, we might have you move up closer to teach just so they can see you better. You can use one of these rolly chairs if you want. There's one up here.
Okay, that's good, because then I can turn.
Yeah. And I think the height adjusts too if you kind of lower it in.
My neck is always sore after this class. Got an old neck. You sure it works?
No. Try the other side. There's a. Just pull it up. Oh, there you go.
It works.
It works.
Okay. All right. Tonight's the nobleman's son. John, chapter 4, starting with verse 43. Yeah. So everybody get their Bibles out. You better have come with your Bible or your phone with your Bible on it. I think one of the most prominent or frequent excuses I ever hear from people who don't believe in God is, or are agnostic towards God, is that he's very capricious. Have you ever heard that? That he's sometimes right there and sometimes not, and you never know whether he's going to act or whether he's not going to act. And so how can you trust him? Have you ever heard that or ever felt that?
Uh-huh.
Yeah. This particular miracle addresses that, and it's, we're going to have to dig tonight, but that was the question that came to me. Is God capricious? Sometimes yes, and sometimes no, no matter the situation. Capricious. In other words, he doesn't particularly care about the situation. He'll act if he wants to, and he won't act if he doesn't want to. A lot of people think God's like that. And the Jews, the people of Israel, were having somewhat of that problem. during the time of Jesus, and because they hadn't heard from him for a while, and they had a lot of problems, had a lot of trouble, and they hadn't heard from the Lord. And so this period of time, when Jesus comes, there's a whole lot of, what I want to say, confusion and chaos around, is God here, is he not here? And so you'll find, if you read history very much, you'll find that there were many, many false messiahs at this time. I think we've discussed that before. There were many prophets that came that, you know a prophet if the words that he gives you in the name of God turn out to be true. And if they don't turn out to be true, then he's a false prophet. And the Messiah is one who works these marvelous miracles, you know, like the parting of the Red Sea and all that kind of stuff. And if you don't have those miracles, well, then God's not paying any attention. And the interesting thing about it is all the gods of the Middle East at that time were capricious gods. So people, if, you know, he was in the thunder and he was in the lightning and he was in, you know, the God, their gods were the God of thunder, the God of lightning, the God of rain, the God of the sun, all these different gods. And they were capricious. They would act when they chose to act and not act when they didn't choose to act. And you couldn't trust them very much. So here comes Jesus. And he is garnering all kinds of attention. And one of the reasons he is because the miracles and the things that he does, I mean, they're real. And so the people are beginning to be interested in him. Their curiosity is raised. So they're starting to collect around him to see if he's truly, the possibly, truly the Messiah. The Messiah they're expecting. And the Messiah they're expecting is the kind of Messiah that's going to open the Red Sea, is going to change everything. So Israel is this incredible, great nation, and their God is the one God. But they've been infiltrated by this, the religions that are around them. So they've been influenced. That's the word I'm looking for. They've been influenced by this. And it's in their face. So sort of like us today, when you watch the news. How many of you turn the news off when you're watching the news because you're being influenced? Some people won't turn on the news because they refuse to be influenced. Mm. So you can see that we can pick up things that we don't know we're picking up. And as the time goes by, they truly begin to shape what we think is good and true. And so this is what's happened in the Middle East, because the people of God are surrounded by all these nations who are violent nations, and they have overwhelmed Israel and Judah and taken over, and they're influencing a great deal. So here comes Jesus, and he is modeling a personal relationship with God, whom he calls Father. Now this is shocking, because this is personal, it's intimate. It's not a God way up there who drops down and causes this incredible miracle to happen. He's walking along, first of all, he's from Nazareth, Galilee. You know about that, right? Nothing good comes from Nazareth, from the Galilee. The people of Judah believed that there were multiple spirits there, and and the people of Nazareth and Galilee were of no account. They counted for nothing. So nothing good comes from it. Nothing good means nothing of God comes out of Nazareth. So God chooses to have his son born in Bethlehem, and comes out, and his home is in Nazareth. So one strike against him. The next strike against him is that he claims, or he operates out of this intimate relationship with God. And that's blasphemy. You know, you can't claim that. You can't claim that you're related to God. So he's got all these strikes against him, but he's working miracles. And that's what they're looking for. They're looking for the Messiah who's going to work these miracles. And a miracle essentially is something good happens that you can't explain. That's the definition of it. You don't argue science, science or politics or anything like that. This is just something that happens through him that you can't explain. So that, oh my, this is really, really critically exciting, very exciting. And so as they begin to follow him, there's this dynamic going on in the people. Who does he think he is? And oh, he's working miracles. Who does he think he is? And oh, he's working miracles. And you can get, as a follower, as somebody who's following and wondering, okay, you can get caught up in this struggle, this competition between the two sides. Who does he think he is? And oh, he's working miracles. Now, this particular miracle, the nobleman's son, happens early in his ministry. He has changed the water into wine in Cana. That was the first one. Then he goes to Samaria and he meets the woman at the well. And in Samaria, we're going to do that healing. That's another one we're going to do. So I won't go too much into that right now. But that's an incredible miracle. That's absolutely incredible. And so things are going real. The wedding at Cana, everybody was excited. Remember the statement? You save the best wine for the last. And the symbolism of water, which meant spirit in the Hebrew world, into wine, which meant wealth and position and richness. So changing the water into wine, the concept in that is just amazing. So then he goes to Samaria, the people, Cana is in Galilee, okay? And not in Jerusalem, in Galilee. So then he goes to Samaria, oh my goodness. And this happens in Samaria with the woman at the well. The concept there is what the people say after he spends 2 days there with them. The woman takes him into the village, tells everybody about what happened. Then everybody sits down and starts to learn from him. And they say, we think you're the Messiah, not because of what she says, but because of what we say and we hear. So he's there 2 days with them. And then he heads back into Galilee. Now in Galilee and Nazareth, what Jesus knows is the last people to ever recognize who you really are is your family, the people of your village. So a prophet is hardly ever known in his own village. Everybody knew that. Oh, it's just Jesus. Mary and Joseph's son. Okay? They can't open up enough to even say the word Messiah. That's what he knows. So he goes back into Galilee, and this miracle happens. I'm going to read it tonight out of the Message, because it's the vernacular is a little bit easier to understand. the Bible is, the Bible is wonderful, and this is very close to it, but it's more in our common language. So, after the 2 days, he left for Galilee. Now, Jesus knew well from experience that a prophet is not respected in the place where he grew up. So when he arrived in Galilee, the Galileans welcomed him. Now, he was quite surprised by that, I'm sure. He expected for small crowds, and he got large crowds. But only because they were impressed with what he had done in Jerusalem during the Passover feast. So they'd heard, they were there, and they'd heard what he had done during the Passover feast, which some of you, maybe you don't know, but that's when he turned the tables over in the temple, acted out a bit, and got everybody to recognize his presence was what was going on. So people were, they woke up and started wondering. Okay, let's see. But only because they were impressed with what he had done in Jerusalem during the Passover feast, not that they really had a clue about who he was or what he was up to. So this is almost always the situation. What Jesus is doing is not what most people are perceiving. So when we do parables class, that's one of the things we learn, is that he teaches in parables, people say in riddles, because only the ones that recognize him and choose him back are the ones that he is willing to speak clearly to. Don't cast pearls before swine. So curiosity isn't enough. Now he was back in Cana of Galilee, the place where he made the water into wine. Meanwhile, in Capernaum, which was the capital city of that area, there was a certain official from the king's court whose son was sick. I want to stop here. Some scholars will say that this nobleman was the centurion. And in Mark, or in Luke and Matthew, there's a story, a healing of a centurion's son. I went back and researched that and read both of those, and it seems like a different situation to me. So I think this is a wealthy man who served in the government in Capernaum. So that's how I'm presenting it. When he heard that Jesus had come from Judea to Galilee, he went and asked that he come down and heal his son, who was on the brink of death. Jesus put him off. Unless you people are dazzled by a miracle, you refuse to believe. So he's in no mood. He's in no mood to play the game, the miracle game. Oh, he's doing all these miracles, and he must be the Messiah. So he refuses to do that. But the court official wouldn't be put off. Come down. It's life or death for my son. The man believed the bare, Jesus simply replied, go home, your son lives. I love that. First, the nobleman has to take a stand. He has to take a stand with this man. So what he's moved from, he's moved from the request for a miracle through Jesus to taking a stand that his son, for his son's need. Okay, so first he's asking for a miracle, then he's asking for his son's need to be met. You see how it's going, the trust is deepening. Because if this is the Messiah, are you going to say, come down, it's life or death for my son? Are you going to say that to the Messiah? So he was driven, desperation-wise, deeper into relationship with Jesus. And then Jesus said, go home, your son lives. Now what's required?
trust.
Absolutely. Instead, I think of faith, in my perception, faith is passive until it becomes active. And when it becomes active, it's trust. Trust is an active word. It's a, you have to take an action to trust somebody. And so Jesus says, go home, your son lives. The man believed the word, the bare word Jesus spoke, and headed home. So we've moved from in-person reasoning, talking, teaching to bare words, just bare words. On his way back, and he headed home. On his way back, his servants intercepted him and announced, your son lives. He asked them what time he began to get better. They said, the fever broke yesterday at 1 o'clock. The father knew that that was the very moment Jesus had said, your son lives. That clinched it. Not only he, but his entire household believed. So trust was completed. This was now the second sign Jesus gave after having come from Judea into Galilee. So the first sign was Cana. The second sign is this nobleman's son. Just lost my page. So tonight, when we're finished, we need to think about these two signs, because all the miracles that we study lead to the resurrection. And it's really difficult. Resurrection life is in everyone. Resurrection life is in every one of these miracles. And each miracle reveals it in a different way. And sometimes the education that comes with this is we're deaf and blind. And we don't see, we have these things going on all the time. And we want this stunning, incredible miracle to convince us. And miracles are throughout the day, all day. And if we don't have eyes to see and ears to hear, we miss them. And that's what's frustrating Jesus here, that the people think that, you know, life is terrible. And it is. Human life is terrible. But holy life is not. And what they've lost is a perception of holy life. They don't have a perception of holy life anymore. It has disappeared through the influences of all the nations that have overwhelmed them over the years, over the 500-year period. So they've lost that perception. So they're basically founded in the legal system. And the holy life is not founded in the legal system. It's found in the personal relationship with God. Jesus models this all the time. He's always modeling this personal relationship, because he's literally, you know, when you come up under an old house and you lift up the old house, and you put a new foundation underneath, that's what he's doing. So when you look at these miracles that way, with that perception, oh my gosh, what's happening here is totally amazing. And when he said it's finished on the cross, the foundation was built, starting with the cornerstone. And that's why we study. We study because we need to understand this foundation. Because when influential things start happening around us, we need to know the foundation from which we come. And that's why we do the miracles. Okay? So, God's will is always to move in such a way that life is renewed. Now, there are different perceptions of life. And the key is, what's your perception of life in this situation? And what is God's perception of life in this situation? So you want to know this one. Have to really know what is God's perception here, then you begin to understand what really happened. This man, this nobleman, was thoroughly convinced with one sentence, one sentence. Mm-hmm. The word spoken. Now at Cana, it wasn't a sentence at all. It wasn't a word spoken at all. It was a physical transformation of a physical substance, water into wine. Here, it's a spoken word. Go back to Genesis. And the Lord said, let there be light, a spoken word. Connect the two. Go home, your son lives, the spoken word. Okay. So, we're not going to do any breakouts tonight. We'll just do it like we did before.
I think so.
Okay.
If we wanted to do some breakout at the end, depending on what time we get done, that clock's an hour off, by the way.
Yeah.
It's only 7:40.
Okay.
It takes about an hour to get everybody in.
To share.
To
mm-hmm.
share.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Yeah.
All right. So we need Jesus and we need the noblemen. We need the Galileans who are curious. Wanting him to, they have a famous person in their midst who is of them. You know what that's like. You have somebody in your community who is on The Voice. Oh my! I know her. I know him. I remember seeing Gregory Peck in a restaurant. I'll never forget.
And the young ones would go. Who's that?
Oh, guys, horn blower. So this is the attitude, all right? The attitude is, oh, here comes our famous Nazarene from Nazareth.
Okay. Well, wouldn't the royal official would kind of be like that, too? They probably thought.
Well, I don't know. Well, see what happens. Too. So we just, obviously had a very, he didn't have the depth of faith that he needed because he needed Jesus to be the one to do it.
Mm-hmm.
So that's what we do. We see the physical first, and the Holy Spirit, when he begins to act in you, he draws you deeper into the basis of who we are, who is spirit. So there's a much, he's always teaching from the spiritual level. Most of us learn from the physical, mental, and emotional level. But you haven't really touched base with Jesus until it reaches the spiritual level. And this one is, I'm emphasizing this because it's so important in this story. Because it's the second key to the kingdom. Okay, now we have the people, we have the nobleman, we need the son. No, we don't have the son in the story. We have the servants of the nobleman, right?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I think we do need the sun. He needs to be in the background. Mm-hmm. Yes, we do need the sun. Okay. Anything else we need? Okay, unless when you pray, you're supposed to be something other than I mentioned. Okay. The nobleman. Who's going to be the nobleman tonight? Let me read it one more time while we pray. I'm going to read it, and you guys just listen for who you are in the story. After the two days in Samaria, he left for Galilee. Now Jesus knew well from experience that a prophet is not respected in the place where he grew up. So when he arrived in Galilee, the Galileans welcomed him, but only because they were impressed with what he had done in Jerusalem during the Passover feast. Not that they really had a clue about who he was or what he was up to. Now he was back in Cana of Galilee, the place where he made water into wine. Meanwhile, in Capernaum, there was a certain official from the king's court whose son was sick. When he heard that Jesus had come from Judea to Galilee, he went and asked that he come down and heal his son, who was on the brink of death. Jesus put him off. Unless you people are dazzled by a miracle, you just refuse to believe. But the court official wouldn't be put off. That'd be pretty natural, wouldn't it? Mm-hmm. Come down. It's life or death for my son. Jesus replied, go home. Your son lives. The man believed the bare word Jesus spoke and headed home. On his way back, his servants intercepted him and announced, your son lives. He asked them what time he began to get better. They said, the fever broke yesterday afternoon at 1 o'clock. The father knew that that was the very moment Jesus had said, your son lives. That clinched it. Not only he, but his entire household believed. This was now the second sign Jesus gave after having come from Judea into Galilee.
Did we mention the household? The people? His family?
Yeah, in the regular Bible, it does say the whole household.
Well, that's, I mean, did we mention
we need them for the characters?
Yeah.
Yeah, so we need the son and the entire household, which would be the mother and maybe siblings and other servants. So yeah, that's lots of parts. Mm-hmm. You know, I think we need somebody else. I think we need the Holy Spirit because that's what's in the words. The words are from the Holy Spirit. Remember what I said is, God's will is always to give life. It's always to give life. It's what form of life? Yes, so we do need the Holy Spirit. So we need Jesus and we need the Holy Spirit to carry the words. All right. Lord God Almighty, kind of trust. Continue to look for the surface miracle. And fail to meet with you. Tonight we ask, Father, that we meet with you and be changed, transformed, healed, given life abundantly. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Mm-hmm. Okay. Nobleman. Who will be the nobleman?
I'll take that.
Joseph?
Yep.
All right, Joseph.
Hi, this is Susanna. I'd like to be the time.
The time?
Yeah.
Oh.
The clock.
The clock, the time.
Oh, 1 o'clock. You want to be 1 o'clock? That's fascinating. Okay.
Okay. I'll be the Holy Spirit.
Okay, Debbie's going to be the Holy Spirit.
I'll be the servants that he meets on the road.
Okay.
I'll be the household.
You're going to be the what?
The household.
Who's going to be the household?
Rich.
Rich man.
Okay.
I'll be the mom.
Mom, so you're part of the household?
Mm-hmm. I'll be part of the household servants.
Okay.
And I'll be the dying boy.
He volunteered to be
the dying. Oh, you're the son.
But
okay.
You can do that
no,
too.
No, that's all right. I'll just keep
to it.
I'll be part of the house.
Okay.
I just know I'm supposed to be there in the house.
Okay.
I'm your sister.
Moses.
Probably a twin.
Older or younger?
Probably a twin. We look so much alike.
That makes a difference. Older or younger.
Sabrina will be the servant.
Okay. We need the Galileans.
We need
people of Cana. So we receive him with great enthusiasm.
Okay, I could be one of those again.
Okay.
I can be a Galilean, so.
I didn't hear that one.
Can be the one.
A Galilean.
A Galilean
as well.
I can be also.
Okay.
That was Bowler.
We don't have Jesus yet. He's always last.
That's where most lines typically. Someone wants to be Jesus.
Who does?
I'll be a servant.
Somebody's going to be a servant? I can't tell.
Liz is going to be the servant.
Liz? Lee?
Yeah.
Okay. All right.
Perfect.
Who wants to be Jesus?
We have a volunteer for Jesus.
Oh, you too. Who's Ollie enough? Veronica.
Veronica?
Yep.
Right, where is she?
Right here.
Oh, okay. You're going to be Jesus, Veronica?
Yeah.
Okay. All right.
And you know, you can put that on speaker view too when we do the
speaker view?
Mm-hmm. Go up to the top on the right where it says view. And put it on speaker. So then whoever has their
Daniel, who are you going to be?
And then they show up.
Who are you going to be?
If they're unmuted, they were not left.
Surprise you. Any of the Galileans or any of the household? Unless you can think of something.
Any more servants?
Pardon me?
Is there any more servants needed?
Servants? Yeah, you can be a servant.
Sure, I'll be a servant.
Okay. You going to be at the house, a servant at the house, or one that comes to meet the master as he's coming home?
Like a messenger?
Okay, you want to be the messenger? Okay. Okay. Do we have more than Daniel? How many messengers do we have? They come.
Servants.
I'll be the servant also.
Okay.
What's
you going to
be? A servant. Okay. Are you going to be the kind of servant that is coming to get the master to tell him his son lives?
What you said?
Are you going to be one of the servants that's coming to tell the master that his son lives?
Yes, that's right. Exactly.
Okay, great.
Do we have a son yet or a child?
Yes, we do.
But that's all right. We can have
more than one. I'm going to be the son too. But you can be a son too. There are going to be three of us as one.
Because the main thing is you're putting yourself in that role to experience what that person experienced.
I was reading that yesterday and I instantly knew.
Hmm.
healed without a direct encounter. Amazing.
Yeah.
Has everybody volunteered? Remember, everybody has to be a part.
I still need a part.
And okay. I do too. Is there a crowd? Can I be part of the crowd?
Yeah, that's the Galileans. Uh-huh. Crowd greeting Jesus as he's coming home and having this wonderful greeting. And he knows that the greeting is based on whether he's doing well or not, like he's pleasing them or not. It's a fan club.
Mm.
Okay, everybody else?
Mm-hmm. I don't know what I am.
So you're one of the Galileans.
Oh, okay. Thank you.
Anybody else?
Let's see. Have we heard from Shadow?
I'm nobleman.
A what?
Nobleman.
I didn't understand.
Nobleman.
Nobleman. Okay. Okay, that's great. She's going to be the nobleman.
Can I get the nobleman too?
Okay, so that.
Yeah. Nobleman.
Okay. Gotcha.
I'll be Jesus.
Okay, Hannah's playing Jesus too. So Hannah and Veronica are playing Jesus.
I'm gonna be time.
Okay.
Okay, so those online, you'll have to remember to unmute yourself when you talk. Okay.
All right.
Can they be muted right now?
Yeah, they can stay muted until they're ready to talk. Just make sure you don't mute us.
Now, talking is during the drama or is it after the drama for them?
One of them they did enter in, like yeah. Jesus especially.
Yeah.
Because
yeah,
we
Jesus
only
is on.
Yeah, we only have Jesus up there.
Jesus.
This is a real weird distance thing.
I tell you, I'm never gonna get used to this. Okay. So we have two scenes. We have the scene in Cana and the scene at the nobleman's house in Capernaum. Let's have the nobleman's house over there, and this will be Cana, and that'll be Capernaum.
Where should the Holy Spirit go?
He travels.
He just travels around.
Okay. Well, he's with Jesus. He starts out with Jesus.
Okay.
He certainly is not in Cana. Yet.
Jesus is in here.
Okay. Okay, so this is the house over here.
Okay, this is the house.
And I'm one of the many sons.
I'm just gonna float around it.
So where's gonna float around? Where's our house?
Okay.
Our nobleman's house is over there.
Okay, nobleman's house.
The servants, are you carrying the message? Okay, so you're with you come from the house. And where is
I'm the servant too.
Okay. So you two are delivering the message to him that the son is healed.
Is it Kevin?
Yeah, you're a son too. Okay. I'm gonna lie down then. No, I'm not. I can't get up.
Look, I'll get.
I'm gonna be sitting in a chair. Okay. All right. And you are
Galilean.
You're Galilean.
Holy Spirit.
You're the Holy Spirit. So you're with Jesus, and Jesus is on the Zoom.
Jesus is on.
Okay. Well, Hannah and Veronica can unmute yourself. Yeah. Khalid is crystal.
Muted.
So Hannah and Veronica. Can I
start? Let's
take the I'm just going to see Hannah. Hmm? He's up there. Oh, there's another number one, too. There's two. Hannah and Veronica, unmute yourself.
Where's
the nobleman? Where's the
nobleman?
Is the nobleman on Zoom?
Okay, too? I'm here.
Okay. Okay. Are Veronica and Hannah up?
Yes, we are up. We are here.
Okay. Where's Veronica? Where is she? Okay, Hannah. We can't find Veronica.
Okay. I'm here. I'm around.
You be Jesus, and your word is right here on the standing next to the TV screen.
So, yeah. So yes. Where they can see you.
Where's time? The camera. We got time is on Zoom too. This is difficult.
Our time is here, and you guys are in Capernaum okay. Right now, right?
Fascinated by you, I really am.
I'm gonna be time too.
Okay. Maybe that's part of our problem. We're all too fascinated with time.
And she's in the
room. Oh, yeah. Yeah. Oh. Okay, yeah, Jesus, go for it.
Okay.
Nobleman.
Okay, well, I'll start. It takes 2 days to get from Capernaum to Galilee.
Mm.
That's a time thing. Sometimes it takes time to get to Jesus.
This Jesus did a lot of things in Jerusalem, and I hear he is here in Cana of Galilee. I will go and beg him to go to Capernaum and heal my son who is very sick.
Yes, I can't lose my big brother. What if my brother dies? Do you really think Jesus could do that?
Sir, come down before my child dies.
It's mountainous terrain. It's a hurry. Long journey.
Hurry, he doesn't have much time.
He's almost dead. 2 days, do you think we can make it? Don't die, brother.
Oh. I wonders.
Jesus, go to Capernaum and heal my son. He is dying.
Unless your people see the miraculous signs, you will never believe.
Please, if you don't come, he's going to die. Help me.
You may go. Your son will live.
Why are you going? Do you really believe?
What happened?
Your son will live.
My gosh. I'm well.
Oh, he's alive.
Oh, he looks so much better.
Oh, praise.
He isn't here yet.
Where's the nobleman?
Oh, well. Wow.
I will go.
Look at our nobleman's son.
Sir, I need to tell you.
There's a lie.
He is alive?
Yes, he's alive. His fever broke at 1 o'clock.
Yes.
Good news, your son is alive.
There is no time difference with Jesus. It doesn't matter the distance. There is no time in heaven. And he always is on time.
Thank you, Jesus.
And he answers the prayer now.
I believe this Jesus now.
And I'm a Galilean following the nobleman in the crowd, and I believe now too.
I believe too. Mammy's little sister.
I guess they're really
an example. I knew it was going to happen. I believe.
I think
we're
famous.
Yeah. I believe. I can't believe he was healed when Jesus didn't even come. It's just amazing. He must be the Messiah.
Irma, fellow Galilean, do you believe?
I do now. I've seen it and I've heard it. I believe.
What are we waiting for? Go get the cow and let's make a feast.
Spoken by a true stomach.
Oh, we at
Jesus.
Somebody else have something to say? Somebody else trying to talk?
No, I'm her servant who said, did Jesus really do that?
Yeah, I think there has to be a testimony from the family that the family is the testimony.
Yeah,
it isn't Jesus that's the testimony, it's the family that's the testimony. It's interesting. Okay. Wow. Okay, I think we passed the test. In the kingdom of heaven, there's either pass or fail. And I think we passed, but that's I think we're just really brave for even trying to be truthful.
Yep.
Okay. Amen. Let's start out with let's see. Let's have the Galileans testify first. The ones that were in Cana that heard the what happened between Jesus and the nobleman. So if you were there when Jesus when the nobleman confronted Jesus and then Jesus confronted the nobleman, what is your testimony?
Actually, I was even there at the wedding feast when Jesus turned water into wine.
Uh-huh.
And the nobleman was there too. So no wonder he had an idea that perhaps Jesus could heal his son. That's what I think. So this Galilean has been paying attention to Jesus just like the nobleman has.
Uh-huh. Okay, so you're following him around?
Yes.
Uh-huh. Okay.
Well, my testimony would be...
Oh, I thought you were finished. Did you have more?
Just one more thing.
Okay.
Actually... Not only am I following him around, but sending messages to the nobleman so the nobleman will know what Jesus is doing.
Oh, so you know the nobleman.
Mm-hmm.
Ah, word spreads.
Yes.
That's an interesting thing. Word spreads. Mm-hmm. Okay.
So you're referring to the incident that when Jesus flipped over the table.
Yes.
Of the Pharisees.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
So I guess my testimony would be Jesus is a good man and he is not superficial and he hates superficialness and presumptuous. So he tips over the table of the Pharisees, and that is my testimony that he is a good man.
He's a good man. Huh. That's not quite Messiah yet, but a good man. So that's a different stage of belief. But it's forward progress.
Forward progress.
Maybe. Yes. Okay. Were there any other Galileans?
Me.
Okay.
What really convinced me was watching the nobleman. He was so insistent. He didn't turn away the first time he asked Jesus. He just kept asking. He must have a lot of faith in Jesus. That he knew Jesus could help him.
Mm-hmm. So when he insisted, you saw the depth of his relationship beginning.
Yes.
That's important. One of the things that happens when you first hear the Lord is you stop listening. You hear something and you stop listening. And as your relationship deepens, you hear something and you continue to listen. And sometimes there's more. So that's important to understand. So you don't cut it off. I used to do that all the time. I'd hear something and it would make sense and I'd stop listening. I'd grab onto those words and want to hold onto those words and stop listening. So I'd start working right away and stop listening. So as you mature in your relationship with Christ, you continue to listen. When he speaks, you continue to listen. So, okay, I won't take that any further. Maybe you will. All right. What are we, where are we, we're listening?
This the Galileans.
Galileans, okay.
Well, I think this Galilean is not very mature. I just woke up, and I was just sort of barely grabbing on to where we are in this story. So I apologize, but I can just say it's really great to hear and see all these different, I guess, like perspectives and people acting it out. As an observer, it makes it more real, I guess, because for me, I have a challenge reading. So anyway, so thank you guys.
Thank you. All right. So that's all the Galileans that reported need to report. Okay. Let's have, let's go to the nobleman. Joseph?
Yeah.
Okay. What do you have to say to us? Your turn to teach.
Persistence pays off, and that you never I'll never give up when I know what I want. In spite of the obstacles that may be ahead of me, I'll trust God that I can get it done.
That's the end result?
Yep.
Okay, what did you feel as your encounters began and continued? What was going on?
Looking at it from Jesus's point of view, I see a parallel in some of the things that happen to us when we give ourselves like Jesus gave himself to people to serve. People did not know that he was about their spiritual life. We live in this physical plane and we want our physical needs met. And I see Jesus sort of felt, you know, sometimes you feel that kind of situation where you see people are trying to take advantage of you when they don't know your motives. But Jesus knew the motives of people. And he said, hey, you guys are just chasing me around because of, you know, you want your physical needs met. What I'm actually about is about the kingdom of God. But, you know, the people were not ripe for that yet.
They weren't. Yeah. He was just beginning, right?
It was just the beginning, yeah.
This was just the second sign.
Yeah.
Yes. Sometimes you need to remember that. What stage of development the person you're working with is, including yourself. Mm-hmm. Okay. Jesus. Where's Jesus? Jesus was Hannah. What's your story?
My story is I see here that the government official had faith. That was number one. He had faith that Jesus will do the miracle for him. and this nobleman believed. So when he believed that Jesus was going to heal the son, that here you see it in the action whereby he was just told a word and he obeyed by returning home. So this demonstrated the faith that Jesus was going to take care of that problem, and he heals the son.
Right. It occurs to me, Hannah, that the believers, the people of God, had the written word, but they didn't have the spoken word.
Yeah.
Oh.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
That's huge. Mm-hmm. So we spoke the words, it's like when you start a car, it ignited something.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Veronica, is Veronica back on? We just really lost her, didn't we?
There she is.
Okay. Veronica?
Where'd she go? There she is.
She's not talking.
For some reason, we can't hear you, Veronica.
Can you hear me now?
Yes.
Oh, my headphones. The microphone on my headphones is not working.
Okay.
So now, now you guys can hear me. As I was like sitting there, I was having that issue and I was saying things, and I could see, like, as we were going through it, just like looking at, okay, Jesus, he had just come off from doing his miracles. He was going into a place where, you know, prophets, it says prophets are not valued, and he was going somewhere else. So what his mindset was of this man coming up to him, begging him to go heal his son, and him, you know, like, it's done. You asked, it's done. And how he left, and how that would feel to have that authority of just telling somebody and giving them that comfort, knowing that it's done. He didn't question him. He didn't ask him, show me a sign. He just went. And within him going and doing that, his miracle was happening. And it just gives me chills, like the amount of faith he must have had, because there's no argument in there. He just went. And so that really hit me, just, you know, that authority and that having that peace. And I think that's what really stuck out to me, is just, you know, that's amazing. You know, just that would be amazing to just have that faith.
So you were surprised, as Jesus, you were surprised that you found that kind of faith?
I was surprised that the nobleman had that amount of faith. He had heard what Jesus was doing, mm-hmm. And he went to him to ask for his miracle. And so I think that it's like, if I was to be Jesus, just the fact of seeing that you're reaching people that way, like, he took it and he went. So I think that's where it hit, where it like got me, like, connecting to my inner Jesus, how that would be, that just, you know, people feeling that comfort and just taking what you're saying when you don't expect that to be the result, I guess is what I'm trying to say.
Uh-huh. So Jesus was surprised.
I wouldn't say Jesus was surprised.
Okay.
I wouldn't say Jesus was surprised. I would say, because it's like he knows everything. So that's where. But I just think, just sitting in that moment, I was surprised, just like,
oh, okay.
Like, I told the nobleman to go and he just went. He didn't question. He did it. He knew it was going to be done.
Okay.
And so, like, connecting to that authority, like, to be in that place of knowing that somebody's just going to listen and go do what you say, and it's going to be done.
Okay, great. Okay. All right, Holy Spirit.
I have something to say, please.
All right, Hannah.
Yes. What I notice here is when this official's faith grew, whereby he believed to ask Jesus for help for his son, and he also believed that assurance when Jesus said that, "You go, your son will live." There he acted on that, and he left and he went. So I see here that he and his household believed in Jesus. So what do I have to say is that faith is a gift that grows as we use it. So if when you use that faith, it is something that will keep growing. We don't have to just wait and be there, but you act on the word that Jesus has told you to do.
Excellent, Hannah.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay. Faith is in the feet.
Yep. Yes, exactly. Exactly.
Keep moving.
Well, okay.
That's kind of what I was referring to in my mind as far as the Holy Spirit was going, is that, you know, when Jesus told him to go home and he did, you know, that to me is faith beyond faith. Mm-hmm. That he didn't ask a question, he didn't say anything, he just turned around and he started on his way home to see how his son was going to do. And by listening to the Holy Spirit, I feel that the nobleman, when Jesus uttered those words, he felt and knew the Holy Spirit within his spirit that Jesus is the Messiah. And I think from him feeling that when he went to his home and he talked with his household and his people, they knew. Mm-hmm. I mean, it was obvious. Mm-hmm. They just knew. Mm-hmm. And that's, to me, that's the Holy Spirit talking to your spirit. And when you listen, good things happen.
Mm-hmm. It's amazing how we actually know the truth.
Yeah.
Every human being knows the truth.
Yep.
That doesn't mean we all accept it.
Right.
But we all know it. Remember, I am the way, the truth, and the life. So we all accept it. We don't all accept it. So there's resistance to the truth because it isn't necessarily what we want. Mm-hmm. And we may want other things more than that. So, and that, in a way, for the Jews, that was an important thing, because remember, when they wanted a king, it was because they wanted to be like all the other nations. They didn't want to be unusual. They didn't want to be separate. They didn't want to be unlike all the others. They wanted the things that the other nations had, which were power and authority, where they could overrun. They wanted a great nation. They wanted a king. They wanted to be like all the other nations. And Samuel didn't want to give him that. They had the judges. Didn't want to give him that. They weren't supposed to be like all the other nations. And finally, God told Samuel, give it to him. And this is what it will cost him. It cost him everything. They were overrun time after time after time. And then they would overrun backwards and back and forth. So peace was something that disappeared. Peace of the soul and external peace.
I have a question.
The difference between what you need and what you want, and obviously the nobleman needed his son to be well. Mm-hmm. He wanted Jesus to do the miracle, and then he needed his son to be well, and he took that stand, and that's when the word came. So it's really, really important to understand when you pray, what are you praying for? Something you want, or something you need, or something that God is willing to give? So capriciousness goes out the window, and this incredible dynamic relationship begins through Christ, your relationship with your Father in heaven. And the soul begins to thrive. Okay, let's see. We got the Holy Spirit. Now we need the family, the servants, the messengers. Yes.
I think the servants were just awestruck by the miracle. They knew that he was healed, and they had to have faith to believe also. So they trusted and had faith.
Mm-hmm. So was there a leap in the depth of faith?
Yes, they were awestruck. They were blown away by it.
Uh-huh. Daniel?
I think Joanna told me real fast. We were there, and all of a sudden, while I was observing, like the Holy Spirit just, all of a sudden, just came down like a shower, and things just took off.
Mm-hmm.
And when I saw the individuals, beginning to jump up and be healed, I was too like that. It was like being at all, so to speak.
Okay.
And then I felt like Holy Spirit came upon messengers, and I was excited. I had to go tell somebody.
That's really interesting. That's no encounter with Jesus. That's a pure encounter with the Holy Spirit. That's the difference. Okay, first, there's an encounter with the physical man. Then the word goes. And when the event happens, then the messengers themselves receive the word. By the Spirit, not by the verbal, but by the Spirit itself. The Spirit, remember that. In the talent or the seeding of the ground, the sower, and how he tosses the seed over all the different kinds of ground.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, here was fertile ground. This was very fertile ground.
Mm-hmm.
So the seed took root immediately through the Holy Spirit, not through the man Jesus.
Mm-hmm.
Very important point. Very important point. So let's just say you speak a word of empowered authority, the Holy Spirit goes out of you, okay? You're no longer in charge. The Holy Spirit's in charge. Don't mess with it. Very important. So the last one to receive the Holy Spirit was the nobleman. Because he encountered and said, what time? He had the faith. But he didn't have the Holy Spirit yet. So he asked the time. Where's the gal in his time?
It'd be me.
Yeah. Okay. When the nobleman recognized the time.
That's when he his faith grew even further. Because he needed to reaffirm, did this really happen at that time? It was really interesting for me because I did the worksheet beforehand, you know, and I asked the Lord, I said, I don't know what to do, you know, and then time stuck out because it's been on my heart, you know, God's timing. And so the first part was the fact that it took 2 days to get to where he needed to go. You know, it's only like 20 miles, but in those days there were hills and valleys and stuff he had to go through. So sometimes God, I'm not quite sure how to put this, but sometimes there's a distance between our prayers and what, you know, he always answers them, but they don't always happen right away. They do because in heaven, there is no time. But for me, it's a waiting process. He always answers, even though it may not be right at this moment, right? And so the 2 days kind of represented that for me. And then the other thing was, sorry, I lost my train of thought there. Okay, so there, like, when Jesus answers a prayer, like he said, go, you know, and his son was healed. It was at 1 o'clock or whatever. And sometimes when I pray for somebody, you know, on the other East Coast or in other parts of the world, you know, the time might not be the same, but yet it is. Mm-hmm. So that 1 hour when he got confirmed that it was an hour, it was for him, he had kind of doubted, I think, there, and he was reaffirming, yes, this is what really happened at that hour when he said.
Holy time and human time came together.
Yes. Uh-huh.
They met together.
Right. So what Hannah said, faith grows as we act. I think that's really what happened for him, you know, is his faith grew. So anyway.
We have one other person that was tying too. I think Bolor was tying.
Okay, let's get her. What's her name?
Bo. Was it Bolor that was?
No, I was one of the Galileans, actually.
You were what?
I was one of Galileans.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Did you prayer? What was your experience?
Yeah, I actually I have thought probably Jesus came to the Galilee. This means they honor Jesus, right? Jesus know these people, then they will honor him, and then also they welcome Jesus. This means they are like kind of open-hearted people, you know? They welcome Jesus. That's why Jesus showed their miracles. I think so. That's some thinking.
Okay. Thank you.
Welcome.
There was somebody else who had time too. I don't know who it was though.
Yeah, I know. I can't remember who it was.
That was me. Ariana. Yeah. I'd like to share about the nobleman, and I'm reading this story from a Mongolian and English book. And in Mongolian, they said he believed Jesus' words, and I'm really thinking about that. He believed his word. Then I'm learning we need to believe God's word. That's the main thing I learned from this story. Mm-hmm. I'm not sharing about timing.
No, I'm thinking about when you hear the Holy Spirit, if you hear that Holy Spirit speaks to you, don't we see confirmation? Don't we see confirmation that it is a true word?
Yeah.
And that's what happened.
The man believed Jesus' word. Yeah. He just believed what does he say. That's the main thing.
Nobleman received, and then went home, and it was
confirmed. Didn't go home. Yeah. If I am, I cannot believe like that. Maybe. I don't know. I'm just thinking that way.
Yeah. Let's go back to what I said. You keep listening.
Are you sure? Really? Or something like that. Maybe I'm going to say.
That's the Pharisees, the arguing spirit.
Yeah.
Okay. I just think about, you know, here you are in Mongolia, and we have someone in Switzerland and Uganda and East Coast, West Coast. And it's the whole time thing.
Yes.
You know?
Oh, yeah, that's right.
It's just, to me, it's just such powerful evidence of the Holy Spirit is with us and among us, and
yeah,
where we are, or the time between us. Pretty amazing. Yes.
Yeah. Okay. That's so amazing. Thank you.
All right, family.
Wow. Well, there's, as the mother of the son that was healed, there's no greater miracle I could have seen ever. I gave birth to him, and then Jesus just basically brought him back to life. So if I wasn't a believer before that moment, there's nothing that could have been greater to me.
Wow.
And I was the sister, and I just became so profoundly aware of how the things of this earth pull on our faith to take it away. That we see the sickness, we feel the sickness, we feel the pain, we hear, you know, it, all of these senses that we have in this earthly realm tug at our faith and say, look, he's going to die. Mm-hmm. What makes you think that Jesus, I mean, because they hadn't really seen Jesus heal anybody before. They didn't even know that that's what he did necessarily.
Yeah, he had done a physical. Water into wine. And this was a human being.
And that's something I had paid attention to in this, is that that was just his second miracle. And the first one wasn't a healing of anybody. So anyway, that was, for me, it was like so distracting to see the physical illness and the fever and the, you know, near death.
We should have had the fever. We should have had somebody be in the fever.
Yeah, we should have. I was wiping Romy's brow with this.
Cindy, I want to say agree, because I have many friends who are sick and ready to be with the Lord, and that's, I think, why time was so important to me, because it seems like I pray and yet Jesus doesn't answer, you know, in my timing, right? So I hear what you're saying. So important to when you see people that are love the Lord, especially who are dying from these diseases, it's horrible. It's really hard to take.
Yeah. And then for me, when Romy jumps up and starts doing jumping jacks, it's like, whoa! What happened here? I mean, you know, but there was that sudden contrast of, oh, he's going to die, and it's so horrible. And then all of a sudden, what happened? That would definitely make a believer of you.
So I was a servant in the household as well, and I was observing this, and we were preparing for his death. We had lost hope. We had run out of options. And so when all of a sudden we felt this, the whole house kind of changed. We saw his jump up, but then we also saw he wasn't just better. He was better than he was before he even got sick. His eyes had a sparkle. His voice was back. He had energy. He had like this renewed life in him. And it was so night and day different that we could not say that it did not happen, that he wasn't sick. He was so close to death, and he sprung up. And it was so obviously a miracle that we, this other servants and I, just, we were just blown away, because we knew this could only be a God thing.
No explanation other than God.
So are there some others that we've missed that we already went through your parts? We want to make sure we give everybody.
The two sons and a rich.
I was part of the household, basically. Yeah. My take on this is that, this Jesus guy, you know, it isn't like they had Zoom back then, you know, they heard about this guy probably. Everybody hears these rumors, but you know how mouth to mouth, how things change. And so probably the majority of people in that country, since they hadn't seen Jesus, they're just hearing rumors about Jesus from whoever says it. And they probably, you know, may have said, well, you know, that turning wine, you know, water to wine miracle thing, you know, maybe that wasn't too legit. Maybe he did something there, you know, maybe they could explain that away some way. And, you know, he's just another kind of a guy just going through town trying to make, get attention, show himself to be more of a gimmick guy. And so, but this miracle, like to them, was suddenly legitimized him, because this, there was no way you could trick this. You know, this is, this happened, and there's no other explanation. In their eyes, they say, this is a true blue miracle. You know, I saw from my eyes, and it starts to open the door that this guy is the Messiah. So that's my take from 20 miles away.
I was a servant,
and what I'm thinking is maybe maybe servants were together with the master's son, a royal officer's son together, and they first saw how son is healed immediately. He was dying, but very suddenly, very unusually, he get better. The fear left him, and they were very, very shocked by scene, because it was very unusual, I think, because he was dying and suddenly, just momentarily, he healed. And then they very shocked, and then very happily ran from the Capernaum to the Galilee to see his master, royal officer, to see him. His son is well, he lives. The servants were running, and on the way they met him. And when the master, this nobleman, inquired the time, the very moment when Jesus said, son was healed, right? Whenever they heard from the master this testimony, this confirmation, when master is making confirmation, they may be secondly shocked, and they immediately touched by Holy Spirit, and they believe it, trusted God. That was a very, very saved and happy moment of the servants, I think. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Joy.
Mm-hmm. Joy, yeah, very joy and happy.
That's an attribute of the Holy Spirit, right?
Yes.
Awesome. Okay, any other servants or household members?
So I was a servant, and so today has been a really memorable day, because it's like we've gone from low to high, you know, like all low to extremely high. So I'm sitting watching my master's son die, and I'm worried about what's going to happen to him. I'm worried about how is my master going to take this. I'm worried about what's going to happen to me.
Uh-huh.
And he says he's going to go see this Jesus. And we only know that Jesus turned water into wine. And I'm worried about, well, is Jesus going to be able to heal your son? You know, we only heard about him turning water into wine. What else can he do? And then my master goes, and then all of a sudden his son comes back to life. So it's kind of like I go from this really low, and then all of a sudden it's like, wow. So really Jesus can do this. So I feel like as a servant, all of a sudden I have an encounter with the Lord, because I'm sitting wondering if he really can do all of that. And then all of a sudden it becomes, you know, a day of celebration in my master's household. We're amazed at the wonders of God. We're amazed at what God can do. And I no longer just hear what he could do, but I actually see it. It becomes, you know, something which I can actually say. It's no longer hearsay to me, but it becomes an experience which I can actually talk about. So I mean, this is like a wonderful day of celebration for all of us in the Master's household.
Life-giving.
Yeah.
Yes.
I was also the servant that was rushing back to tell the officer the good news, and just kind of putting myself in that place, in that position. Naturally, as servers, we want to make the people that we're serving make life a little bit easier for them. So when we experience a miracle like this, we just get extremely excited, and we want to be the first to share the good news about this amazing miracle. And so I just put myself in that position, and if I heard something or saw something of that great of a miracle, I would be the most excited person to go out and share it right away.
For days and days and days, right, Chanel?
Yes, yes.
For all of your life.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Let me tell you a story. This is what happened. Yes, I think all the members of the family became storytellers.
I took this position because I don't know when I read what the position I take. And then right now there's a choose the nobleman. That time the nobleman, his son very sick, and then he looking for a way to how to heal his son, and then went to the Capernaum, and I think he very worried about his son, and then maybe looking for something doctor, I think. And then he heard about Jesus was there, and he knew how was Jesus and water into wine. And the first time he met him with in Cana in Galilee, and then that time he was, I think, very astonished for his miracle, and maybe he think about maybe that was very never see like that miracle, that maybe he's Messiah. I think he about that, and then he heard about Jesus was in Capernaum. He only way to see Jesus is he think about is heal his son, and then beg Jesus, and no stop, and they continue to ask him for Jesus, begging for heal his son, and then Jesus say the word, and because he believe his word.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
He disappeared, huh?
Then
no longer present.
Yeah, then he just take a word and went to back to home.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes. Yeah.
Thank you.
Yes. Thank you.
Okay.
Ready, Romy? Mm-hmm. Okay, now the son's going to share.
Well, for me, it was,
so everybody can hear.
For me, it was very good because I was very sick and I couldn't do all these fun things that I used to do. I was just stuck at home and sick, and I was seeing all these people coming home, and I didn't know what was happening. And all of a sudden, I just felt like this electricity in me, and I was cured, and I didn't know why. All of a sudden, I went from being very weak to very strong, and I was so excited to be able to do all these things that I wasn't able to do. And it gave me grace and to be grateful about, you know, my health, and to be thankful to God, because when my dad came back home, everybody started to believe, and they started praying. So it gave me another way of seeing life and being more appreciative about life.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah. But okay, I was also a son. Was there anybody on Zoom that was a son? Weren't there three of them? Who was?
I was. I don't know if anybody else was. I think there was three of us, but for me, the death, or you know, being that sick, it was numb and dark, and the sudden surge of what you called electricity. Yeah, I felt a surge of energy or power, and all became light, and the darkness felt like it was fully expelled or pushed back, and the jumping up, taking action, and then to breathe in life. And then there was a physical sensation of, I'm hungry. Sorry.
That's cool. Oh, thank you. That's cool. Okay, I was a son too. And I didn't hear the word because I quit. I was laying there suffering, and I quit. I quit trying to survive. That was a weird feeling. I just let go. Okay, I'm done. So I wasn't struggling anymore, and I wasn't listening either. So I missed the word that Romy heard and that you heard. I missed that word, but the movement of the Holy Spirit itself woke me up. And I was not empowered until I came up and joined Romy. When I came up and looped my arm through Romy, it was like, oh, okay. So it wasn't really, I didn't really know anything except that I felt better until the nobleman and the servants came home with a story. Then I connected, oh, that's what happened. So I received the healing without the word, and got the word through others, which is, again, you know, I was fascinated by the Holy Spirit, the word leaving and going through the Holy Spirit, going to the sons. But in observing, I was fascinated by that. But by experience, I received the life before I received the word. So remember, there's different ways of receiving life from the Lord. So just because somebody doesn't do it the same way somebody else does, doesn't mean it didn't happen. And I think the key here is, as I listen to everybody, the key seems to be a repetitive, keep listening, keep listening. And the healing will come. And with time in present, with the concept of time present, the healing comes when holy time overtakes and rules human time. So every healing that you know about, if you compare one with the other, you can only see the continuous movement of the Holy Spirit when you look from holy time and not human time. So let's just say you look at the resurrection of Jesus on the third day from the tomb, and you think holy time, that's still part of the process, because holy time met human time at Pentecost 50 days later. So holy time and human time was in Jesus. Holy time was leading, and it entered man at Pentecost. Was it a burst? Like there was a burst in the home, there was a burst at Pentecost. So, you know, we tend to, we tend to talk about our encounter with Christ or someone else's encounter, someone else's story, but we don't have that sense of the continuous life-giving movement of the Holy Spirit on earth as it is in heaven. He is always moving. He is always giving life, and he gives it generously, and our perception has to come from our encounter. The nobleman was key. He asked for what he needed. He insisted, he asked with great strength. He asked for it. He was sure that was what he needed. With confidence. So he asked with confidence. The Lord granted it by word. The word went out. It's a continuous movement. Do you see? It went out. It filled the home. And from the home, it came out into the world where they met on the road. And the nobleman realized, okay, it was at that very moment when the word was spoken. So holy time is, I need a word, somebody help me with it. Holy time is an
infinite time.
An encounter that has life in it. And that life is a living energy. It continues to heal and heal and heal and heal and heal. So we tend to humanly speak, there's an end to our story, but there is no end to the story of the Holy Spirit on earth as it is in heaven. There is no end. It continues.
Is that word you were looking for, transcendent?
Yes. Explain to me what you mean by transcendent.
That it's well, I'm struggling for finding words now, but it kind of permeates isn't really the right word though, but it sort of, it's almost like it's continually active and
yes,
kind of goes everywhere or something. I don't know how else to say it.
Yes, and those who have ears to hear and eyes to see will encounter it.
Infinite time and space.
You know, I've been part of the ministry for 40 years, and one of the very primary lessons we had was from Betty's mother. And it was one of the very first lessons any of us ever learned. And she taught it to her daughter, Betty. And the lesson was, God is everywhere. That was that simple. God is everywhere. Mm-hmm. And most of the time, we're unaware.
Yes.
And that's the beauty of this healing. It is so many were changed because the Father needed his Son to live. That's a very important sentence. The Father needed his Son to live. Now hear that sentence in the physical and hear it in the spiritual. The Father needed the Son to live.
That is interesting, Elsa Jane, because this is a physical father who needed his Son to live.
Yes.
And looking at it from that spiritual perspective you just mentioned, the Heavenly Father says he has many other children. And sometimes, in most times when we pray, a process is set in motion to involve other people, other sons and daughters of God in the process. We are looking at it from our own perspective, from our own need. But the Heavenly Father is looking at the needs of many others along the way.
That's right.
Mm-hmm.
That's right. The Father needed his Son, but God the Father needed
many more people to come into the fold.
Yeah, many others did.
Yeah.
Yes, sons and daughters. It's a beautiful story, don't you agree?
Certainly.
Yes. Yes.
I was looking at the chat. Julia wrote, infinite time and space. The official, his faith and his actions working together, James 2:2. Mm-hmm. We have, let's see, who hasn't spoke? Solange, have you shared?
Yes, thank you, Jane, for today's lesson. And I was a nobleman, and I'm learning so much things. And first, Cindy teaches us that faith is an act, and he's a real model for faith. And he's going to the Capernaum to Galilee, and he's asking for Jesus, heal my son, and also he, when the Jesus said, go to your home, your son lives, and he directly returning to go home, that is the so amazing faith. For example, for me is asking, I cannot exactly turning back. Sometimes I'm, no, please, God. And so hard to directly following God. That teaches me so much things, and also reminds me the nobleman is exactly Matthew 7:7. It reminds, he asked, he seek, and he knocked. It's open, and his son is healed.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah. And disciples were probably learning a lot, wouldn't you agree?
Yes.
Yes.
Sorry, it's my clock.
Thank you.
Who else hasn't shared? Kirk, you haven't shared.
No, I'm pretty shy when it comes to sharing. It's got a lot to do with faith, my faith in Christ. Believe that he is capable of doing all things, and the nobleman, his faith in Christ, it was amazing that he believed that his son was healed. I'm kind of dealing with something similar myself. Do I believe that Christ is going to heal me through this process that I'm going through, and do I have faith in him? And do I believe that he is capable of doing that? Yes. Yes, I want to believe that. But sometimes we struggle to believe. But I do want to believe and trust in my heart through this process. So I will keep my faith upon him and hope upon him, if that makes any sense. I'm done.
Thank you, Kirk.
The Father needs the Son to live.
Hello.
Mm-hmm.
Did we break up or something?
Can I share?
Yes.
Okay. When I read that chapter, I had marvel that faith of the officials, that man, his faith is very, you know, brilliant, because he got that words and then made action, and that's why I was so marveled. And so God has infinite that holy time and space, and Holy Spirit is everywhere. So So God gives grace and saves, heals those who trust in the Lord and open their hearts. So James 2:2, you see that his faith and his actions were working together, and his faith was made complete by what he did. So also, Luke 9:56, for the Son of Man come to seek and to save the lost. So I got the verses comes in my head, like that verses, and also Jeremiah 17:7, but blessed is the one who trusts in the Lord, whose confidence is in him. And also that James 2:17 is opposite of that second verses, like in the same way faith by itself, if it is not accompanied by action, is dead.
Yes, yes.
Yeah, I got those things. Thank you.
I love that word confident. Yeah. That's what happened in him, wasn't it?
Yeah. When
your son will live. Go home, your son will live. And confidence, all of a sudden there was the confidence. The plea became confidence.
Mm-hmm.
Wow.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Uh-huh. Okay, Tricia, we haven't heard from you. Figure out how to push the unmute button.
Okay, I think I got it.
All right.
Oh my. Well, I was speaking earlier to you about the mother and her position. And, you know, she wasn't there like the nobleman to see the water turn to wine. You know, her husband comes home and tells her about it. And then, you know, in desperation, as any mom, you would send anybody to do anything they could to save your child. But to actually have the faith to believe in her husband as well, that what he saw, and to send him and have the faith that he would get there, to me seems an important factor as well.
Mm-hmm. So let me ask you a question. When your son was healed and your husband wasn't home yet, what happened? What'd you think? Remember, the son was healed before the husband got home.
Well, you would just have the revelation of knowing that he made it.
So you would,
if you had enough faith to believe him about the first miracle and you had enough faith to help send him, then once your son was healed, I mean, I'm sure at first you would be ecstatic, but, you know, in reflection, you would probably think about it before he even got home that, oh my gosh, he made it, and there you are.
Huh. So you recognize it, did you recognize that Jesus didn't need to be there for the healing to happen? Because remember, your husband went to get him.
Yeah, but I think in reflection, you would know if he went to get him and he was who your husband said he was. I would think you'd just know.
Oh, okay.
Thanks, Trish.
Okay.
I have a question.
Okay. Is that Kirk?
Yeah. Yes, Kirk?
Yes. You guys said the nobleman. Okay, can you hear me?
Yes.
Can you hear me?
Yes.
Yes, the nobleman, when he turned to go home, do you think he had completely faith that his son was healed, or was he rushing home to see to make sure? It's hard to imagine how strong his faith was at that time.
I think he obeyed. The words were
really, really.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. He just obeyed.
Okay.
And Kirk, if the Lord spoke to you and said,
go home, your son is healed. The Lord spoke to you. Would you immediately obey or would you question? Would you also question?
That I would have a hard time to answer that right now because I wouldn't know. But I would hope that I would obey and believe. In, yes.
Because it was the truth. It was the truth. And you would recognize it. Every human being recognizes the truth. All do not accept it. You would recognize it.
Yeah.
Therefore, you would obey.
Holy Spirit, you're right.
And right, exactly.
Yeah.
Okay.
Thank you.
Everybody.
I think so. Did we hear from Sabrina?
Nope. Thank you. I was a servant. And in the beginning, I was scared. And I was so surprised that my master would actually go somewhere to go get someone instead of sending someone else to get this person to bring him. So I was pretty shaken up that it was my master humbling himself. And then I was very sad that his son was super sick and worried. And I knew it was a very serious thing for our entire family and the entire household that here the nobleman is humbling himself. He's leaving us. And I knew he had to be desperate to do that. And at the same time, I felt this fear that here we are caring for our master's son, but it must be something huge that our master's going away. And so whatever he's leaving us for must be really serious and powerful. And even in that he was leaving, I felt that there was something very powerful. And then in the study before class, I really felt there was a miracle even in the obedience of the nobleman, that when God gave him the word, when Jesus spoke the word, that was a miracle, mm-hmm. that he even heard the truth. Like Kirk was saying, that he even heard the truth is a miracle. In my spirit, to even hear the word of God, I know requires miracle, requires spirit, requires the Holy Spirit to act.
Requires the action of the Holy Spirit to be able to hear. You're right.
Yes. And I felt that was a miracle, which as a servant, when he came back, the entire testimony was the testimony of hearing the power of the Holy Spirit and the power of the Holy Spirit. You hear it and it moves us. We obey because we're willing. And
that's important. That our
will. We're healing. We're willing. Yes. That's what I took away from it.
Father was very willing because he needed the son to survive.
Yeah.
So he's willing in place.
Thank you.
Thanks, Sabrina.
Thank you.
Okay, I think we've had everybody share.
Okay.
I do have one important question though for Colleen O'Brien.
Colleen, you're gonna get a question.
Okay, on the spot, what?
Could you get your luggage?
Yes.
Okay.
It's now Tuesday morning at about, what time is it? I can't see. About 6 a.m., I think. Now 4 a.m., I don't know what time it is. But when yesterday, which might mean nothing to you, but anyway, the day before the day it is now here, I was between therapies and I walked to my room for just like 3 minutes And I opened the door and there were my two big suitcases. I was so thrilled. Just for everybody else, what happened is I traveled to get here for some physical therapeutic stuff. Anyway, but my luggage was lost on the flight. And in the luggage was all of my books, all of course, my clothes, all of my everything. And so I was very distraught, but it showed up.
Where are you, Colleen?
I'm in the southern part of Switzerland right now. I'm in a clinic and I'm able to stay here, but the clinic is in Switzerland. Wow. You know, it sounds really exotic, but frankly, I'm just inside a building. I mean, it is exotic in terms of healthcare, but I'm not really seeing it. It could be anywhere. It could be in my garage in terms of, you know, seeing things, because I'm just inside this building. And I took a cab from the airport to get here, and to leave, I'll do the same thing. They want me to avoid public transportation if possible because of the whole COVID thing, you know.
Sure.
Blah, blah, blah. Anyway.
Well, you're in Switzerland. That's where I'm from.
Oh, really? Nice.
Okay. I couldn't leave without asking. Okay. So Sabrina says she has an emergency prayer request. What would that? Go ahead, Sabrina.
Thank you. I had an assignment from Hannah a couple weeks ago when I was really struggling and needing some prayer. And I waited to ask for prayer. And it made a difference. Looking back the days that I lost struggling. And when I finally confessed my need for prayer, it immediately, the Holy Spirit stepped in and went to work. And so my sister-in-law, Teresa, has stage 4 cancer, and she has been getting palliative care. She has to stay very far away from her home to receive care, and her young children are in their 20s, left their hometowns and their jobs, and have been caring for her because she needs 24-hour care in a home they're renting temporarily so she can receive palliative care. But she went into the hospital tonight. Okay. And we haven't heard any more than that. And Teresa is her name. She loves the Lord. And the last time she was in the hospital for some time, she really felt distance from the Lord, and she felt oppressed, and she felt she couldn't feel God's presence. And so my prayer request is for the Holy Spirit to guide you guys in prayer for Teresa and for her to feel the presence of God during this really tough time. Yeah. Thanks for letting me share that.
There we go. Thank you, Sabrina. Elsa Jane, you want to close this in prayer tonight?
Sure. Holy Father, we come to you because we know that you're the source of life. We also know that life is eternal, and that part of receiving that eternal life is death. And we're not afraid, because death has been overcome. Sickness has been erased. And the kingdom of heaven is here. Mm-hmm. Sometimes, Father, pain is so great, suffering is so deep, that we cannot recognize you with our mind. And we choose, Lord, for the sake of Teresa, to recognize you with our being, that you will fill that hospital room with your presence. And Teresa will remember in every fiber of her being that she belongs to you and you're there. You're with her in her suffering.
Yes.
Cause her to remember, Father, we ask in Jesus' name. Cause us all, Father, to remember, to walk and move and have our being in remembrance of you. For you are the life giver and you are in us. And we must come home and live. Mm-hmm.
Yes.
Every day, all day of our lives. For you are our ever-loving Father, and you need your children to live.
Yes.
Just as you needed Jesus to live. And he did.
Yes.
And we follow.
Mm-hmm.
God bless Teresa.
Mm-hmm.
God bless her family. God bless us all.
Yes.
In Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Okay, we will see everybody next week and we'll begin studying life histories.
You can't dismiss us yet. It's not after 9:30. We've not got out before 10 so far.
No. Run while you can.
Just teasing.
We have been like fake.
Have a good laugh, I'm sure. Okay.
All right. All right.
Good night, everyone.
What are you taking this class for?
Thank you.
You're
welcome.
You.
My pleasure.
Good night,
everybody.
Thank you.
Good night.
Bye, everybody.
Good night. Thanks,
teacher. Bye. Thank you. Bye.
Thank you. Good night.
Yeah, thanks, everybody. Bye bye.
Thank you, Cindy and Elsa. Thank you.
Good night, Cindy. Good night, everybody.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mama Elsa Jane. Thank you for the class.
Love you. Thank you. Bye bye.
Bye. Bye. Thank you, everyone. Bye.
God bless.
God bless.
That is so good.
So, Elsa Jane.
Yes.
You got time either Wednesday or Thursday to go to lunch?
Hello, everybody.
Good night.
Good night.
I turned mine off here. I forgot that one was still on.
For lunch, let's see, Wednesday.
In here.